So I see we have 5:30. I'd like to convene this regular meeting of San Lorenzo Valley Water District Board of Directors for May 18th, 2023. Carly, would you take role, please?
Yes. President Smalley?
Here.
Vice President Hill?
Here.
Director Ackman?
Sorry.
Here. Director Foltz?
Here.
Director Mayhood?
Here.
Okay. Any additions or deletions to the closed session, Rick?
Staff has none.
Oral communications regarding items in the closed session. This is for members of the public that want to comment on any items that are part of the closed session. I see one.
Hi, I'm Bruce Hall.
Yes,
from Boulder Creek. There was a, when the district council was hired, it was about 5 years ago, and there was a public process that took several months. Mm-hmm. A number of different law firms were interviewed, and at the end of the process, Director Foltz and I were two members of the public who both recommended that Nossman be hired. And so I wanted to mention that the reason that I thought that out of all the law firms that were interviewed, they should hire us because out of all the questions that were asked, I really couldn't find any differences with Ms. Nichols or there was a senior partner named Al Smith, as I recall, who also came from Nossman. There were definitely reasons why the previous district council was replaced, and I've been happy with Ms. Nichols ever since she was hired. I'm only a little bit sorry that they're quite so expensive, and that the district has to spend so much time defending lawsuits from the county in particular. But I think there's a problem that's happened lately, and that has to do with item 9, President's Report. I think you've got a brownout problem here. And the way it played out at the last meeting, so from my perspective, this is an unagendized item. I mean, you can call it President's Report if you want, but basically it's open-ended, so open-ended it could be anything. And that isn't really consistent with the Brown Act. Brown Act says each item needs to be described, what it is you're going to talk about. So at the last meeting, it was the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency was the topic. They had accepted the GSP. And there was discussion. There was board discussion. And Mr. President, you never offered the public a chance to participate in that discussion. It says here on the, your agenda is pretty much the same as last time. Discussion may be limited at the chairperson's discretion. Well, that kind of contradicts what it says on the previous item, oral communications. It says, the Brown Act limits what the board can do regarding issues not on the agenda. No action or discussion may occur on issues outside of those already listed. So if the board thinks, if the president thinks that this president's report item, by putting this on the agenda every week, that you've carved out a place on the agenda where you can take up an unagendized item and have a board discussion like you did last month, and not allow any public comment the way you did last month. Mm-hmm. I think that's against the Brown Act. I think that's illegal. And so I think that, so this is really my first time of having a difference with Ms. Nichols. If she thinks this kind of an item is compliant with the Brown Act, I disagree.
Okay.
And I guess I have two more things I want to say about it. It says president's report, but you know this.
Mark, I apologize for interrupting. I just suggest deferring this discussion for the open session agenda, given that it's now pertaining to an item that's listed on the open session agenda.
I can concur with that, and yes, you are correct. Since I'm describing a legal issue. But since you presented the information that you wanted to comment on, awesome, which was part of the.
Well, how do you know that I'm done? I'm not done.
I understand that, but to Ms. Nichols' point, when you were then commenting on the president's report, that is part of the open session agenda.
I don't know what the president's report is going to be this month.
I understand that, but that's part of the open session agenda. That's not part of the closed.
If the district is not complying with the Brown Act, that has to do with district council's evaluation. May I finish?
So you're commenting on the fact that she's not.
I'm commenting on the fact that you see a pattern in practice. You have a pattern in practice of carving out a place on the agenda for an unagendized item and limiting public comment on those reports. May I finish? May I just finish?
Okay, go ahead. Please wrap up your comments.
So, from my perspective, see, this agenda is your work product, Mr. President.
Yes.
Okay, so every word on here is your report.
It's mine, but it's the district's.
You and the district manager together come up with this.
Yes.
Okay, so if there's any topic that you think needs to be on your agenda, you are in a position to put it there. You're in a position to describe it effectively so that a member of the public can understand what it is before they come to the meeting.
Are we not observing time limits for public comment?
I'm sorry, Jamie, could you say that again, please?
I was suggesting that we typically have time limits for public comment.
And I didn't see that. We started the clock at the beginning of this.
I think if you had let me finish, you know, we would be done by now. So what I'm trying to say is that the whole agenda, from my point of view, is president's report.
Right.
You get to introduce every item on the agenda. You get to introduce every speaker. You can acknowledge every speaker and interact, you know, tell them what you want them to say or what you want them not to say. You have so much discretion that I don't see why it's necessary for there to be a special item just for you. And I want to say one more thing about this is that I saw the same problem.
Okay. You asked twice, can I continue? Can I continue? Can I continue?
Because I was being interrupted successively.
Thank you for your comments. Okay. Proceeding on then. Do we have anybody from the public in attendance remotely? I'm seeing any. Okay, then I'd like to adjourn to the closed session.
Okay.
We have three attendees.
Right.
Okay, I see. All right.
Okay, I checked that. Okay, I'd like to Reconvene this meeting of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District for May 18th, 2023. Kelly, would you take roll, please?
Yes. President Smalling?
Here.
Vice President Hill?
Here.
Director Ackman?
Here.
Director Foltz?
Here.
Director Mayhood?
Here.
Okay.
That was me.
We have, we took no actions during the closed session, so we have nothing to report from that. Rick, any additions or deletions to the open session agenda?
Yes, give me one second, please. Staff would like to pull item 10B, the biannual draft budget for fiscal year 2023-2025. The draft budget went to budget and finance. There was some significant changes requested, and which would have been totally in contrast to the budget that we're looking at tonight. We will return, hopefully, first meeting in June.
I object, actually, because I actually spent quite a bit of time preparing for that part of it, and apparently maybe not to a good use, but there are a couple things that I think I'd like to make sure we get back when that budget comes to us, which wasn't included on this one. And so I'd at least like to have a brief conversation about that and not pull it.
Is it appropriate for the Budget and Finance Committee to receive those comments directly?
Not directly without violating Brown.
Yeah, I think that's the problem. If certainly Bob could send them to Kendra and Rick and make sure they're... I would like to ask District Council about what the rules are about pulling something from the agenda, who can decide, et cetera.
Sure, the president could allow for it to be pulled in the absence of an objection. Given that there's an objection, it would be appropriate to vote on whether to pull the item.
And yeah, I think it's a super majority, is it? By board policy?
Not to pull an item.
Is to add an item.
Okay. Yeah, that would be correct. That would be to add an item late to the agenda.
Yeah, I mean, on big items like this, it would be really great from a time management point of view to have advance notice of that. I'm just, my time is worth something too, and preparing for something that is not appropriate, we could get a heads up on that beforehand. That would be really great.
Part of the problem was that we had to reschedule budget finance, and it was Wednesday or Tuesday.
Tuesday.
And so we ran up against a lot of time restraints, but I totally understand.
I understand, Bob, and I apologize. And
just, I don't mean to interrupt, but did we lose Director Ackman?
I'm here.
Okay, I just didn't see you up there. I just wanted to be sure that you made it.
So the procedural then, as I'm understanding from Gina, is that we vote on this. Correct, Gina?
Correct.
Okay.
Right, and if a majority agrees with the, if there's a motion and a second to pull it and a majority agrees, then it would be pulled from the agenda.
I would like to move that we pull item 10B from tonight's agenda.
Second.
Okay. Carly?
President Smalley?
Yes.
Vice President Hill?
Yes.
Director Ackman?
Yes.
Director Foltz?
No.
Director Mayhood?
Yes.
Okay. Moving on then, oral communications. This is the portion of the agenda reserved for comments from the public on items that are not on our agenda this evening for discussion. I see several members of the public in attendance this evening. Does anybody want to comment? Seeing none, we will move on then.
There's one in the audience.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see you.
You're behind the post, Bruce.
Thanks. Okay. I'm Bruce Holloway from the record. I didn't really have anything planned to say at this point, but I also cannot see Director Ackman on screen, and I don't have access to those names that you're referring to who are in attendance. So I guess, you know, hybrid meetings are a new thing.
Yes.
But I remember going to water district meetings for years when I could see all the other people who were in attendance. And I can't see those names that you have. And this came up in the last meeting, too. So I think somehow you've got two screens here that have identical images. I think maybe it'd be better to have one of these screens the way it is, and the other screen would be Director Ackman remotely, and the names that you're looking at on your screen. I think we should be able to see who's in attendance. Thanks.
Let me exit and see if that helps. Good. Jamie up there.
Okay. Moving on then.
Jamie is up.
I have nothing for the president's report. So unfinished business. Rick?
Okay, unfinished business of the Shopman Wheeler Construction Support Services Extension for the Lion and Big Steel Pipeline projects. And we have the district engineer, Josh Wolf, here to present that item to the board.
Thanks, Rick. This is a contract amendment which is intended to allow us to pay Shopman Wheeler for work both already completed and to be completed on the Lion and Big Steel project. They have done a very good job of being accommodating and working with us when scope changed repeatedly on this project. And now they are asking to be paid. With that, I will take questions.
Okay. All right. Questions. Bob, since you're part of the engineering and environmental committee, I'll let you lead with this, but I do want to say that that committee has not seen this submittal. We did not review this or comment on it, but from that perspective, any questions on this
item? Yeah, a couple. What was the amount of the original contract?
The original contract amount was $341,100.
That's another $100,000 more or less.
Roughly, yes.
When did we, from a contractor management point of view, when did we get the notion that we were going to exceed the contract?
I'm going to have to defer to Rick on this because I think it happened. Rick, I'm going to have to defer to you on this because I think it happened before I started.
Bob, can I get you to repeat your
question? Yeah, sorry. So when did we get, from a supplier management point of view, when did we get the notion that we were going to be going over? And did we ask them for an estimate at that time of what they thought the bill would be? Or is this all totally they get to do what they want and then come back and bill us in arrears?
They don't get to do what they want, but staff left the scope of work, the original project, several times on this. We added a whole section of mainline that wasn't part of the original project because to get rid of a river crossing. We brought on the CZU fire damage that wasn't a part of the original. Did we ask at that time that we bought the additional work on for an update of where we were with their purchaser? We did not.
So typically you're going to enter into some sort of a change order or
correct
engineering change order process where you're going to say, do this, this is what it's going to cost, or can it be handled under the existing contract? We didn't do that in this case.
Not.
So we're incurring another $100,000.
That's correct.
We didn't manage it.
That's correct.
Okay.
Okay. Jamie, any questions on this item?
I don't have any specific questions, but I just wanted to acknowledge for the Bruce and the audience. I'm in a hotel for a conference this week, which is why I'm not there. And my Wi-Fi is terrible. So I keep going off camera to try and maximize my bandwidth. I acknowledge your concern about wanting to see all the board members. Normally, I would want to be there on camera, too, but it's just terrible here. So thanks for your forbearance.
She was up there.
John?
I have no comment.
Okay. Gail?
I guess I had a little bit of the same comment as Bob. Is that I think I understand how this one happened because the CZU fire, you know, really complicated our lives in that interval, and there's mission creep, and we have, in some ways, we have to be really grateful that they were willing to take that on and not, you know, hold our feet to the fire on the details of what they were doing. But at some point, it's important, you know, that we try to formalize it. So I think we just want to make sure that they understand that this isn't something that's going to happen again, right? That they can continue to come back and, you know, and now that we're out of the CZU, or slowly emerging from the CZU mess, that we don't have this recur. That's all I would say. But I think, given everything you've described, it seems reasonable to me.
Let me go through a few questions first, since I have some also. How does this scope of work that we're now adding and the costs that they're coming back with compared to the original contract and the items? Are we getting reasonable? Because they're sole source to us right now.
Yes. I believe that we are getting a reasonable return for this $100,000. The change order is going to cover, in addition to previous changes of scope, which entail the addition of about 6,000 linear feet of pipeline, abandoning a river crossing, the addition of several PRVs, changing a bit of how our system works in order to allow us to eliminate at least one pump station, Blackstone, and to get the Bear Creek pump system revitalized, essentially. In addition to all of that, plus a bridge crossing, which is not a small undertaking. There's the additional survey required for that. And I would say that design plus the portion of this $92,000 that moves forward, which is construction support, submittal review, RFI review, help with change orders, that sort of thing, throughout the life of the Lion project. And simply the fact that the original project has been broken up into four separate projects now, I think we're getting a pretty good bang for our buck here.
Okay. And to a point that Bob was bringing up earlier, and that Rick has already commented on, I understand that we as the district were requesting interim cost updates for what does this change now cost us. But I assume it's likewise that Schaff and Wheeler wasn't doing that either.
Correct.
So they get to the end of their budget and say, we're not done with your work yet.
If we were not adding scope and changing the existing scope on them, I would agree with you 100% that was a problem and not to be tolerated. Mm-hmm. We have changed the scope on them.
Right. I understand during the process of the last 4 years, but you're saying that we're going beyond that now. And the things that you're describing to me now are changing, going forward.
Correct. Okay. And this amendment does include budget for going forward.
Okay. All right. That addresses the questions that I had on the thing. Okay, Bob.
No, I've Jamie or Jeff, and then come back to me.
So. Okay. They've already.
Oh, they've already said no.
They've already passed on asking.
So
everything I have to say is this already been cut. Yeah.
Of the changes here, how much was directly related to CZU?
Approximately 17% of the overall Lion project is CZU, or will be FEMA funded. There are further impacts to us that are non-monetary that change the design a little bit based on CZU. And that's really the...
Yeah, so a minority of the projects, I get that. I mean, if these guys are that good, and there's, well, I guess, depending on how much infrastructure we actually end up doing, maybe there's a different kind of relationship with them that isn't so much pay by the drink, but, you know, pay by the bottle, right? And I'd certainly be willing to entertain that with them, particularly given almost $500,000 worth of business. That's a fair chunk of change. Because typically what you do in that case, if you're going down that route, is you will get slightly better rates, because it allows them to plan their staffing as well, right? Which for a consulting company is important. And by the way, as a consultant myself, you know, I'm sure they told you that the change of scope is going to impact the overall statement of work as you were going along. It's just everybody basically agreed we weren't going to deal with the monetary aspects at that point in time. Having been a consultant myself, and I've done exactly that many times, I understand why they did that. But that's where it's incumbent upon us to basically say we're not going to do that. Okay, I just wanted to make sure I got a few things clarified in that. By the way, it's no small thing to get rid of some of these extra things that we're getting rid of. That's a big plus for the overall infrastructure. So don't get me wrong, I'm okay with that. But when we're dealing with our suppliers, we have to have a particular process on how we're doing it.
Okay. Well then, given the responses in that, I'd like to make the motion that the district manager amend the existing contract with Schaffner Wheeler for design and construction support services related to the Line Big Steel Zone Pipelines Improvement Projects in the amount not to exceed $92,300.
I'll second that.
Okay. So before we vote, I'd like to hear if the public has any questions on this item. Seeing none. Carla?
Okay. President Smalley?
Yes.
Vice President Hill?
Yes.
Director Ackman?
Yes.
Director Fultz?
Yes.
Director Mayhood?
Yes.
Okay. Motion passes. Moving on then to new business. Labor negotiations.
Yes, and District Council is here to present this item to the board.
Okay.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Rick. Can you hear me in the boardroom?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to provide just a little bit of background before talking about the proposed addenda that are in the board packet for which we're seeking board approval, because this is the first time this has been on an open session agenda for a long time. We've primarily been meeting in closed session for purposes of the negotiations. For anyone who isn't familiar with this, the district has two groups of employees for bargaining purposes. The district has the management supervisory and confidential employees unit and a classified unit that's represented by the union. Each of those two groups has its own memorandum of understanding or MOU with the district that establishes its terms and conditions of employment. Those include a salary schedule for each position within the district, each employee's position within the district, as well as other it also deals with other matters related to employment for the district. The two existing MOUs were last updated and approved in January of 2017. They had a three-year term that expired at the end of 2020. At the end of 2019. When the three-year term expired, the MOUs then renewed automatically each year, year by year, because nobody gave notice to renegotiate the MOUs. In 2022, however, September 2022, this past year, all the parties, the management employees, the union, and the district gave notice of their intention to negotiate the MOUs and try to renew or revise them. And since then, we've been meeting, Rick and I were appointed as the district's negotiators, and we've been meeting with the union and the management employee representatives regularly, approximately every 2 weeks, and meeting with the board in closed session regarding negotiations. The result of this effort at this time is not a new MOU for each group. Instead, what we have done is determined that the district needs to conduct a salary study before completely overhauling the MOUs. And the purpose of that salary study would be to determine what the average compensation package is for similarly situated employees at similar public agencies. As sort of consideration for the time it's going to take to complete the salary study, the two sides also agreed to some other terms and conditions that are all set forth in the two addenda that are in the board packet. The terms are essentially the same for the vast majority of the terms are the same for all employees. The key terms are summarized in the board packet, and I'll just quickly state them here. All the employees are going to get a total, if the board approved the addenda, all the employees would get a total cost of living increase of 6% for an inflation experience last year. Each employee would receive a one-time payment that's not PERSable of 7% of the employee's base salary. The district would issue an RFP to hire a salary study consultant within the next, I believe it's 3 months, and complete the salary study within a year. And after that, we would establish new salary schedules for each employee based on the average compensation as determined by the salary study. Also importantly, whatever salary increases the salary study may show are appropriate in order to reach the average compensation would be implemented gradually over 5 years. So those increases, any increases wouldn't take place all at once. They would take place at increments over 5 years. And the total salary increase for any one position would be capped at 25% of the current salary. We have heard from the management unit representatives that they're prepared to sign the proposed addendum for their group. And we did hear on Tuesday from the union representative that the classified employees did vote to approve their addenda as well. So if the board adopts the recommended motion that's in the board packet tonight to approve the addenda, then they will be signed on behalf of all the parties and implemented. And we'll continue to talk to the employees while the salary study is underway about things other than compensation, so that when we get the salary study back, we'll be in a position to hopefully get new MOUs in place fairly quickly. And with that, I'll answer any questions.
Okay, thank you, Gina. Okay, as Gina said earlier, the board has been discussing this for the last several closed session meetings. So we've had the chance to understand what was going to be in this memo and the agreements that we have in front of us. So with that, I'd like to see if the board has Any additional questions or comments on that? Jeff? Yeah.
I guess I'll just echo that we had lots of frank discussions and in closed session, and I think we ended up with a situation that reflects the efforts that our staff have made on our behalf through both the pandemic and the CCU fire, and it puts us on a road to making sure that we're paying competitive rates, but maybe doesn't give them everything they wanted, but we also have to watch the bank account of the district. So I think it was a pretty good compromise. So I'll vote yes.
Okay, Jamie?
Well, I very much agree with all of the comments that Director Manhood put forward, and I would really like to hear from the public before we have a conversation about where we're at, even though I'm, you know, largely in support of everything that we're doing for our employees. But, you know, I feel like this is the first opportunity that the public's really getting to sort of comment on where we're at with the agreement. So I'd love to just hear from the public at this point.
Bob?
Yeah, I have a statement to read. Thank you for your patience. I believe that our government agencies work best when operating with the consent of an informed public. The duty to inform goes beyond the minimum legal requirements of pointing to a website or publishing an agenda twice a month. The duty to inform must include providing critical context and facts from which our community can base their decision to provide or withhold consent. As I've said before, the Brown Act minimums are a floor for transparency, not a ceiling. Ultimately, this means we must tell our community the truth, good, bad, or ugly, and the full truth, not just the part that is politically comfortable. We have a duty to provide full context through aggressive outreach and not sugar-coated PR pieces about how good things are. We should honor and assume that everyone in our community works hard at what they do, but we must also support those that have struggled from years of numerous challenges and assure them that asking for more money to pay district bills is done only with a serious, open, and transparent process. Unfortunately, this board did not do that with respect to the employee MOUs and is continuing to follow the policy of previous cycles of MOU negotiations. That path culminated in serious community discord and a significant Prop 218 protest vote on rates in 2017. As in 2017, this MOU extension is being offered to the public after a completely secret process, with this information sprung on the community at the last second in a manner that ensures no one will really notice it until much later, probably in conjunction with the coming rate increase. In the future, we must instead follow the leadership of other agencies in California, like the City of Costa Mesa and the Palo Alto Unified School District, who conduct negotiations privately, but publish the proposals made by each party so that the community has complete transparency into not only the negotiating positions, but also to the reports showing the impact of said proposals, particularly on operating budgets and therefore on rates in our case. So we are doing that compensation study, therefore staffing and operating expenses will most likely increase even more than what is contemplated by this agenda item, since these studies simply ratchet compensation in a round robin style among the local agencies. The results speak for themselves. Between 2015 and 2025, the end of our current budget look ahead, staff costs will have at least doubled. That's an increase of 7% per year. That's in the aggregate, not individuals. Staffing costs now account for almost 70% of the operating budget. And still to this day, I can't get an answer as to what our community is receiving in benefits for these skyrocketing operating expenses that they weren't receiving back in 2015. Therefore, as a result, I will not support any proposal that comes before this board that is not part of an open and transparent process, accompanied with multi-year budgets that exceed the minimum definition of multi, and which provide our community with the information they need to make an informed decision to provide or withhold consent. Thank you.
Okay, I do want to comment since I've been involved in the discussions up to this point. From my perspective, these were not easy discussions that we had. I don't believe that the board sided with requests that the employees made readily. I believe that we took a neutral position between requests that the union were making and our duty to the public as elected officials. So with that, I feel that the board did our jobs we've been elected to do, and that was to have these difficult negotiations, and this is where we are at this point. So I'd like to, I see that Director Ackerman would like a follow-up comment. Jamie?
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to add to that that, you know, I was unaware of the comments that Director Foltz was going to make, but that in my experience, and I have been through public agency negotiations both as an employee, as a manager, and now as a board member, I have never seen them done in public in the way that Director Foltz suggests, and it would be a disservice to our employees to do that. So with that, I would love to hear from the public.
Okay, I would like to see if anybody from the public has questions or comments on this. Seeing none, then I think we can move to I want to make a motion to approve the attached addenda and authorize their execution on behalf of the district.
Second.
Okay.
Okay. President Smoley?
Yes.
Vice President Hill?
Yes.
Director Ackman?
Yes.
Director Foltz?
No.
Okay. Director Mayhood?
Yes.
Okay. Motion passes 4-1. Okay. Moving on then. The consent agenda. Does anybody have any objections to what we have in the consent agenda? Not. Moving on to.
I do want to thank Holly and Rick for putting the comments in from both Gail and myself. I thought that was very helpful.
Okay. District reports. The district manager's report, Rick?
I have nothing.
Okay. Department status reports. So questions on the engineering report. Jeff, anything on engineering?
No.
Okay. Gail? Bob?
No comment.
Jamie?
Nope.
Okay. I have a couple. Any issues yet on the Fall Creek Fish Ladder construction implementation?
No.
Okay.
And you have no idea how pleased I am to say that.
Yes, you do.
I can imagine.
On the Fountain Heights, on the Fountain Heights tank, are we stalled on this? Seems to me like we saw the same thing in a report.
That's because there's been the same thing report after report after report. Rick, you know more than I about where we are in Fountain Heights.
Yes, we're working on putting together agreements to enter the property to perform geotechnical review, survey review.
Got so it. The property owner then is agreeing.
Are agreements in front of them?
No, they're not.
Great, thank you.
Okay, but conceptually, he's.
Yes, the property owner conceptually.
Okay.
So what you're saying is that the paperwork is not finalized for people to sign.
That's correct.
Okay. All right. Environmental, Bob?
Yes, question on grants. So I'm not sure there's been anything added to the table for a while. And so while I think the, even if we back out the grant for Brackenbrae, which, I mean, that's a special case, we're still looking, I think, at about a 40-to-1 return on investment, more or less, so far. But are we seeing a slowdown in grants that we're have a chance of being able to get?
Right. So right now we're kind of in this waiting period of where we have quite a few grants open that we're waiting to hear if we were awarded or not.
Can we not did, apply for more?
We can. Yeah. It's just kind of waiting for those different periods to open. Right now there isn't all that much we could be pursuing, especially related to infrastructure. We did just get a firehouse hardening grant for $300,000. Yeah. That's through the IRWM or the Integrated Regional Water Management. And that's through the Community Foundation, which the board approved. So we did just get that award announced.
So what you're saying is there's nothing for us to apply for right now. Is that basically the case?
Right now, there are different programs we're looking into. So we are looking into the state revolving fund for the consolidation projects. And that's going to be a pretty large application if we do decide to pursue that. There's just some waiting periods in between, but we are still looking for different grant opportunities, and as soon as they do open, we will pursue them if they're relevant to us.
In your experience, are there grant opportunities for infrastructure repair as opposed to new construction?
Not really. No, unfortunately, most programs won't fund repair or maintenance. Right. That's pretty rare. So if we can make the case for, you know, fire hardening or, you know, that's really the in for infrastructure, it seems. If we can say, you know, we have these redwood tanks that would benefit, you know, fire flow if we were to upgrade them or harden them, protect them from fire and make the public safety argument, then we have a chance. But it is still kind of a gray area.
And probably no chance on recoating the tanks.
No.
Right.
Yeah, maintenance is really not considered anything for grant funding.
Okay. Because all of our steel tanks, except for the recently installed ones, are well past their required maintenance period.
We can go after loans. So low interest loans are our next option. And, you know, there's pretty good programs. I think the city was just awarded a huge loan, so a low interest loan.
Yes, but right now I'm not sure our debt coverage ratio would support that. I'm still waiting for that number. So
I think we'd be pretty tight on that.
I think we'd be pretty darn tight on it, actually, especially if you back out the $1 million in surcharge money, which really isn't able to be applied to that kind of thing. Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay. We are still under the, I see on the environmental report, the water shortage stage two. We talked about that in a previous meeting. When did we, or how do we say we're not under that?
Well, Mark, we never do. We didn't do it in 2017.
But I wasn't here in 2017 to ask that question. So how do we?
That, I mean, it is a board decision discussion. I think what Rick and I have talked about is it's a little difficult because a lot of these grants that we are currently pursuing, we did make the argument that we're in a drought situation. So, you know, we might risk these applications.
These grants before we back all the way out.
Well, we were in a drought situation when you apply.
Right.
So is it based on your application date or your reality?
That's a great question. Yeah.
Can we look at that and find it?
Yeah, we can definitely see which ones are grant.
Which ones are vulnerable?
Unless we think that announcing that we're in a stage two when we need to go to that, it really does send a message. Otherwise, why?
We backed off on our messaging.
I understand we backed off on it.
We discussed but going back, but we've been hesitant.
I mean, and basically in 2018, I asked the same question, Mark. believe it or not.
Yeah.
And it never happened, right? We stayed in a stage two. So when we actually went to the 10% more the district asked, it was actually going to a stage three, even though we formally didn't want to do that. So we were not really being straight with our community at that point.
Yeah. Mark, I'd suggest limiting discussion on this unless it's going to be agendized.
Right. Understand. Thank you for closing that off, Engina. All right.
Can I make a recommendation that we agendize this for future discussion?
Okay. Rick, did you hear that?
I did hear that. And we can bring that back to the board.
So put it on a future agenda so that we can talk about it. Okay, moving on then. Which one of these are we under? Finance. Jamie?
Yes.
Any questions from
you?
Finance? Okay.
No, thank you.
All right, Bob?
Yeah, I don't know if Kendra's on or not, but I was curious as to if she's made a determination, given that August is coming up pretty soon, on the past due bills. Don't we have to submit something in August?
I do believe she has, then she is on.
And of the number that's greater than 30 days in arrears, what percentage of that do we expect to recover through that property tax process?
We just sent out our first round of letters, and you'll also notice in the past due analysis that there was a decrease of 3% from February's past due. So I think that was, a combination of us sending out the letters, letting them know that we're getting ready to go to the property tax roll. And so I think that kind of sparked people to, be like, oh, I need to pay my bill. But I believe when we ran the report, it was about $270,000 worth of past due accounts that we sent letters out for.
What percentage is that? A little over half? Well, over half of the total or over half of the greater than 30 days?
Greater than 30 days.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, only half. That seems low.
I could go back and double check and get a more definite answer for you. I would just need to look into.
Might be an agenda item at some point.
So I didn't hear that clearly. Over half of what?
Over the greater than 30 days in arrears, because I don't current receivables. I don't care. Right?
So, but I mean,
I don't know if it's 50, 55, 60, it's just over half.
So over half of the greater than 30 days are being submitted to.
Right. And again, not to dive into this too deeply, yeah, but I think this is something that either the board or the Budget and Finance Committee can take a closer look at, because we are three months out or 2 months out. So
yeah. I do know we did place a threshold on it as well. So that could have something to do with it. So I can do a deeper dive into that and bring it back to Budget and Finance.
Great, thank you, Kendra.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff, we're still on finance, any questions?
Lots of little things that I want to bring up in committee, but.
Okay.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Outstanding.
All right. Anybody have any questions on legal? Seeing none, I'll move to operations. Gail, anything on operations? Jeff?
No.
Okay. Bob?
On the water being taken from wells, are we off that, or are we going to be on wells for going forward?
Right now, we are not running our wells from pure surface water. We've only been running the wells for maintenance, and the quarterly well drawdown report will be in the July operation.
Okay, great.
Strong, still pretty strong.
I was going to say, I hope so. Yeah.
But
it's also, we also have some issues in distribution and restrictions and so forth. We only move so much water. But with the new pipelines going in, that will remove all those restrictions.
I thought the restrictions were mostly south of
that. That was down in Quail Hollow. Now we have one in Boulder Creek with the Lion steel pipeline.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay. I do have one question on our operations. Do we have plans to do a leak detection survey?
Yes. Okay. Yes, that begins on June 5th, and it'll be running for 15 days.
Great. Okay.
That's the only question. Carly actually just asked me for the paperwork for that, so the social media posts will be going out with that.
Good. Okay. Committee reports. Any questions, comments on those? If not, I think we can adjourn this open session.
I just recommend ensuring there are no public comments on any of the reports before adjourning.
Okay, thank you. Any questions, comments from the public on staff reports? Seeing none?
Chair, we are reconvening back in closed session.
We are.
Okay, so I just want to make sure council knows that and make sure we follow those procedures.
Okay. All right. But council was not attending at the end of closed session.
That is correct. And will not be attending this closed session.
But we do need Director Ackerman.
That is correct.
Re-sign on to the go-to meeting.
That is correct.
Okay.
Could I just check, is any advice needed regarding reporting out at the end of this?
I don't believe there will be, Gina.
There's not going to be.
If it gets to that, I can call you. That's permissible.
Okay.
If we run into an issue like that, I don't believe we will. It's just information.
Okay. Yes. If you need me to jump back on to the open meeting for a report out, let me know. But it sounds like there won't be any, and so there won't be any need to get back on here.
Okay. Thanks, staff.
Rick, do I need to return after
you
closed session?
You can go, and I'll just record the times that are coming back.
Okay. Thank you.
You can put it back on that. We're going to close session. CTV, we're going to close session.
Record.